this will be Grace Part 20. You know, it may seem I hope it doesn't seem repetitive. Of course, I know a lot of it is, but you realize the depths that God can open up a scripture to you. So Grace Part 20 may seem like, my gosh, but we could spend, if you could, spend eternity discovering the grace of God. So what bothers me, one of the many things bothers me, is I hate a catchphrase religion. You know, catchphrase. And of course, belief systems are all summed up in what we call catchphrases. And summed up in free willers, absoluters, Jesus only. Have you guys heard all these terms? Calvinism, Lutheranism, and all these other isms and all this. So you just gotta see Paul's message to the church in Ephesus and in Colossians is that they put off the old man and be renewed in the spirit of their mind and put on the new man. Paul says, I want you to understand this. Now this may be real simple, but you guys are all facing me. So if I told you guys to turn around and look at the wall behind you, now listen, Paul says in Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 3, when your heart turned to the Lord, it's turned to see what's there. I say the wall behind you because I wouldn't ask you to turn around and see something that wasn't there. Do you get what I'm... So when I say turn to see Him, I'm not telling you that Jesus is so far off. Christ is in you. And until you turn to see Him in your hearts, He's going to be distant. You know, the scripture says hope deferred. Y'all know what deferred is. You ever had anybody owe you money and they deferred? Yeah. You ever owe anybody money and deferred? Makes the heart sick. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. Now think about that. I'm not telling you a hope deferred here. I'm telling you, as Paul said, put off the old man. Be renewed in your mind, in the spirit of your mind, and put on the new man. Turn to see Him. What happens when you turn to see Him? The veil is taken away. What is the veil? The veil is, Christ took away the veil a long time ago, though. Only veil now is the veil that our old man, the old man being the religion, has put back up. Why? Because of the same thing the Israelites did. God never says, Moses, you better hide your face when you go down there. They said, Moses, we don't want to look at this glory. So they put a veil up. So that's what we do. Because why do we do that, guys? Why do we do that? I'm going to tell you why. It's why all these seats ain't filled today. It's because people feel the shame when they see the glory of God. You feel the shame, guys. I'm telling you what you do. Me and Tracy was talking last night, and she was talking about, boy, I would hate to be a preacher because I know everybody thinks you're Mr. Goody Two-Shoes. And they do. That's why I try to be incognito. I don't... The old man, the Levitical system, the judicial system, put it off. You know what? Let me say this, guys. Let me say this. We hear all this stuff about religion, and it'll be preached every morning, every Sunday morning. It'll be preached all over the world this morning, religion. And you know what? Every congregation is against it. You know? I mean, this is the modern catchphrase. We're all against religion. We're not one of them religious. B-O-L-O-G-N-A. I don't know why they put an A on the end of it. It should be E. Baloney. Right? or a Y. Bologna, B-O-L-O-G-N-Y. So we all say we're not religious. Do you know what religious is? I'm going to give you the definition here according to the Concordance. It's ceremonial observance. But I want you to think about something. I'm just going to throw this out. This is kind of food for thought. We'll get into this heavier at another time. But you know what religion is? Let me just tell you what religion is. Religion is when you try to bring God through your prayers, through your ceremonial observances, through your worship services, through your praise services, when you try to bring God into your world. Yeah. Listen to what I just told you. Look and read the scriptures, guys. Was it always not getting them out of where they were?
Yes.
Was it not? Is not Paul telling them, put off the, trying to get them out of the old mindset and bring them into the new? So now let's go back and look at ourselves. Are we religious? I know just this very week, we try to get God in our very circumstances. Now listen, why are they a circumstance? Let me just bring this real simple. You know why it's a circumstance? Because you're in it. Am I telling you the truth, guys? If you wasn't in it, would it be a circumstance? See how simple it is? So put off the old man. Because Paul would tell us, you are seated together with Christ in heavenly places. Raised up together to walk in newness of life. A new creation in Christ Jesus. Seeing this, put off the old man. Over here, the new creation, why we don't want to see the glory is because we're in the old condemnation. We're in the old system, and in the old system, there's condemnation. So we put a veil up because we don't look through. But over here, the new, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Y'all ever go read the book of Revelation and you'll see, come up here, John. Come up here. Come up here, John. Come up here. Moses, come up the mountain, right? Noah, build an ark, we get you out of this world. Israel, kill a lamb, put blood on the door, I'm getting you out. It's always getting you out to get you in. What did you say? I'm the door. This whole body of sin and death, the old man has been put away by the cross. Now let me tell you something right here. Here's a verse I never understood till just a couple weeks ago, a week and a half ago. I will probably mess this up, but just bear with me. I'm in Proverbs 9 and 10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding. But I want to look at this phrase. The fear of the Lord is the beginning. Y'all know what beginning is, the start. Of wisdom. So wisdom has a beginning. And what's the word that's at the beginning? Fear. Now, remember, this is King James I'm just reading it out of. So does this mean we should be scared of God that he's going to break your legs and give you a stroke and all that other stuff? Let me tell you what it really, really means. And you can take this over into Matthew 13 with the seed that sowed the or the sower that sowed the seed on the ground. Nothing wrong with the seed, right? The fear of the Lord, that word fear means reverence. And you remember I said a couple of weeks ago, God does not want to be number one in your life. He wants to be the only one in your life. Big difference, guys. You know, everybody Sunday morning's got God number one on the totem pole. You know, Wednesday he might not be number one, or Thursday he might not, but on Sundays he don't want to be number one. He wants to be the only one. And when you begin to reverence God in that manner, that's the very beginning of wisdom. Let me say it this way. When he becomes of all importance in your life, that's just the beginning of wisdom. When he becomes of the utmost importance. Now, remember the sower that sowed those seeds? They fell on four types of grounds, right? Only one of them brought forth fruit. You know why the other ones? What happened? They got choked out. The sun scorched them. fellow. Why? Because the word of God, which is the seed, which is Christ, had no importance in their heart. Do you see what I mean? So when the word of God becomes important in your heart, that's the beginning of wisdom. It's just the beginning. And I want to cover a few things today that you'll see. Why is this important? Because I want you to turn to see Him. And as long as you're over here caught up in this old man Levitical system, religion, trying to bring God into your world, you know, guys, I know this is going to sound strange, but some things just, they really burn me up. I turn on the radio, and I hear this statement, pray for Susie, or whoever. They really need, y'all know the rest of it, a touch from God, right? Sometimes I think, what the heck are these people thinking? Does God, is He sitting up there going, man, Clyde, I'm sure glad you reminded me to pray for Susie. I plumb forgot. I was busy over here. Concerned about, you know, and, you know, Clyde said, Lord, you know, I just want you to know about Susie over here. All this, you know, or God's up there saying, you know, guys, that's not enough. Only Clyde and two others ask. Now, when y'all get 47 in a prayer chain, then I'll do something. It's like, oh, God, we've only got 44. We need three more. Come on, guys, we need three more because God needs to touch. It cripples the people. Where is Christ? Christ is in you. Turn to see Him. And we have no wisdom. We have no wisdom because of the situation we're in. We only want out of the situation we're in. And God is saying, I have already got you out. I'm not going back to the cross again. The blood is already on the door. Come into the house and eat the lamb. Come into the house and eat the lamb. Remember, he was talking about serving sin. Serving sin that we henceforth should not serve sin. Seeing that there is therefore now no condemnation. Now see, the old man will jump up and say, great. Grace means I can do whatever I want to do. I like your religion. Just get a six-pack. Party. Right? Paul says, come on. Should we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? That's not grace. You can't measure grace by sin. We've been over this and over this. And it's just foolish to measure grace by sin. It's not. Grace made you dead to sin. Grace is the cross. Grace is the blood on the door. Grace is, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Let me go to Romans, and let's just look here at something real quick. Romans 6 and 7. Here is the work of grace. Now, let me back up to verse 6. Knowing this, how are you going to know something? Where does wisdom begin, guys? The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So if you're going to know something, have some experience of something, the Word is going to have to start taking some priority in your heart. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with Him, this is right where we were last week, do you know that your old man, your religion, your everything that you were is crucified with Him? Of course, the Him here is Christ. Why? That the body of sin might be cleaned up. God, come and clean me up, but you know, I'm just an old sinner saved by grace. Everybody says a sinner saved by grace needs to read this verse, and I'm going to tell you what, you got the wrong mindset, because He didn't save the sinner by grace. He destroyed the body of sin. There's no sinner saved by grace over here. You're a new creature in Christ Jesus. How can you continue to serve sin, seeing you're dead? The body of sin is destroyed. He did that by the cross. That henceforth we should not serve sin. As more you put on the new man and renew it in your mind, you won't serve sin any longer. Now, you know the old verse, he who the Son makes free is free indeed. Here it is, for he that is dead is freed from sin. That's past tense, F-R-E-E-D, freed. You are freed. You do not have to, sin does not have to reign in your mortal bodies. Listen, guys. Yes, these mortal, corruptible, stupid brains that we have always lust to do something selfish. They lust to do dumb things. They lust to do whatever it is of the Adam nature. They do, guys. I'm telling you what. You ever just go down the road and or just anything and bad thoughts go through your mind, thoughts that you're ashamed of will come up and you think, I'm supposed to be a Christian. How in the world can I be having these thoughts? But Paul tells us there's still no condemnation. We can bring every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. In other words, every time one of them thoughts comes up, boom, the cross stands mighty. And I turn to see Him. And let me tell you what, every time you see Christ, it'll be as seeing the Lamb slain. You can read that in Revelation. There He was. I opened the books, and there He was. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah hath prevailed, and I looked, and I saw the Lamb as it had been slain. Why? Remember when He showed up to them people there? He had nail holes and prints. He always shows up as that right there. Why? Because that is your always going to be your first encounter with grace. And when you see Him, you realize, knowing this, that our old man is crucified. Sometimes we have to turn right back around. Almost every day, we turn right back around and see that cross. Because those thoughts start rising up. And then I'm thinking in my mind, I know this, I know this, I know this, but how are we changed? We're always changed in seeing Him. So we turn to see Him who is freshly slain. Not slain again, but our view is always of the slain Lamb. He only died once. And this is the work of grace, for he that is dead is freed from sin. It was fulfilled in Christ, and now by Christ it works in the believer. And we call that salvation. The salvation of the Lord. That the grace may abound unto eternal life in you. Well, here's a good question. See, when I'm reading, I'm looking, okay, eternal life. What the heck is eternal life? That means I'm going to live a real long as eternity is, I'm going to live. Well, let me dispel that. All these things in this body that we have and all things that was written in His Scripture was put into time. A time that we're governed by. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, April, May, June, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock. To point to Christ who stands in no time, not a long time, no time. So eternal life is a life completely outside of that. So I'm thinking, what is eternal life? Well, that's, you know, everybody will say life and life more abundant and all these other things. You know, sometimes it bodes well to just stop and see, what does this really mean? Lord, show me. What does this really mean? Let's look at this verse in John 17. Verse 2. As thou hast given him power over all flesh, this is Christ he's talking about, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. So now we're getting ready to get some eternal life. Remember, we read that over here, eternal life. And this is eternal life. Do you think there's about to be a definition that follows? And this is eternal life. He's getting ready to tell you what eternal life is. Now, he does not say that means a real good life for a long time and a lot of prosperity and never being sick and never growing old and all that other stuff. He doesn't say any of that, does he? I'm just giving you in red letters in King James Bible, John chapter 17, verse 3. This is eternal life, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. This ain't a natural knowing. Now, we started off with wisdom up here. The fear of the Lord is the beginning. What is wisdom? I mean, we... Paul, above all, wanted to know him, that I may know him. Paul said, I gave up everything that I may know him. Jesus says, this is eternal life, that I may know him. Some people want to sit on their laurels and wait and say, one of these days we'll know it all. He said this here in John, and this is life eternal, that they might know thee. This word know comes with the connotation of experience. Adam knew Eve. She conceived. She didn't say, I know that guy. Yeah, she knew him. She experienced him. Eternal life comes with experience. Not just experience about changing a tire, but experiencing Christ. I look at it this way. I hear him break it down in this line and say, touch me, handle me, experience me. See that a spirit hath not flesh and blood as you see me have? I'm real. I am all reality. Spirit, guys, is more real than this piece of plastic I'm beating on. Spirit is the reality. All this does is point to what is the real reality. And that real reality is Christ. So we got to look at some of these functions of grace here. Let's go about putting on the old man and putting off the old man and putting on the new. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 12. 1 Corinthians 12. Verse 1, now concerning spiritual, if y'all notice in italics means it's been added. But here's where we go to find out who can sing and who cannot sing and who can preach and who can teach Sunday school right here, right? Spiritual gifts. That's the way we always use it. Well, let's just stop and look and see if that's what he's talking about. Now concerning spiritual, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. My God, think about this. I would not have you ignorant. This is the Apostle Paul speaking to the Corinthian church. The original text says it this way. Now concerning that which is of the Spirit. Concerning that which is spiritual. He says concerning spiritual things. And the whole thing, if you read this letter of the Corinthian church, is the same thing with the Galatians. It's trouble between the flesh, trouble between the Spirit. It's our same trouble, guys. Our same trouble today is between the flesh and the Spirit. Because we don't discern. We want to bring God down into our world and do all this other stuff to conquer the flesh, which He's already conquered. And He's telling you to come out of it. Okay? He brings all this over into the body of Christ. Now look at verse 2. Ye know that ye were Gentiles, carried away with these dumb idols, even as you were led. Wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus accursed, that no man can say that Jesus is Lord, but by the Holy Ghost. This is the thing that I wouldn't have you ignorant of. Those of you who have been involved with idol worship. Of course, that's not us, is it? None of us are guilty of idol worship. For one thing, we don't know what it is. We think in our minds, in our religious minds, that's worshiping a totem pole out here. You know. Let me tell you, let me bring this down for you real quick. Let me go get a scripture. This is the free part. You know, always in our lesson, we got a free part. This is the free part, you know, in the quotation. Let me go to Revelation 14. Verse 13, I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. Their works do follow them. Works do follow them. Works come later, right? But let me tell you what an idol is. Let me just bring this right down. Well, of course, we'll have to spend some more time. I'm just throwing this out there real quick. When you have an invested interest, because when you do work, don't you have an interest in the outcome of the work that you're doing? Whether it's even a payday. When you have an invested interest in the work, guess what? The outcome just became to you an idol. Now think about that. Well, now what does he tell us to do? Rest. Right? Rest. Now if he tells us to do anything, in the moment that you start having an invested interest in the outcome, what does that mean? What is in it for me? Just became an idol. So now, who is guilty of idol worship? Every stinking one of us. We all are. Why? Because it's our nature as Adam to do that. Now that's just one example, okay? We could go on and on and on. But I'm not here to preach condemnation. I'm here to preach Christ. But he said, you have experience of worshiping dumb idols. And I don't want you to be ignorant of this. These idols, these dead idols that cannot speak. I don't want you to be ignorant of this. I want you to understand that the living Spirit of God, of Christ, operates in you. Now verse 4. I'm back over to Corinthians. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. The word gifts here, I don't know if you guys know this, it's the word charisma. That is the Greek word for grace. Is charisma. Have you guys ever heard of the word charisma? Old Johnny's got a lot of charisma. Now let me say it this way. Now there are diversities of grace, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administrations of what? Grace. But the same Lord. There are diversities of operations of what? Of grace. But it is the same God which worketh all and in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit, what is that? Whatever expression of grace it may be, is given to every man to profit with us. Who is the expression of grace? Christ. Okay? So every function of Christ is an expression of grace. Where does this take place? In you. But the manifestation of the Spirit, which means the expression of grace, is given to every man to profit with all. What that really means is to profit the whole. Now what are we talking about here? Just skip down to verse 14. For the body is not one member but many. Now this is to profit. Now we're in the same chapter here. The same chapter. Remember this is a letter. And Paul is now breaking it down to explain it. He says, if the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear shall say, because I am not the eye, am I not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where is the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where is the smelling? But now hath God set the members, every one of them in the body as it hath pleased him, not you, him. And if they were all one member, where the body? But now are they many members, but yet one body. Because of this, the eye cannot say unto the hand, I have no need of thee. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. Every function of Christ in you and me is for the good of the whole. The building up of the whole to what? Into the full acknowledgement of the mystery of God in Christ. It's for the edifying of the body in love. Remember what he says here in Ephesians. Let me just go get this one real quick. In Ephesians 4:7, but unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. What is the measure? It's full measure. It's the fullness of Christ. And guys, let me tell you this. As soon as you put your hand to one of these expressions or functions of grace, it no longer becomes a function of grace, it becomes a function of the flesh. It becomes man-centered. What did Paul say? Not I, but Christ liveth in me. But unto every one of us is given these expressions of grace, that it may be to the good of the whole. Grace, charisma. It's this grace, these functions of grace, denoting and enabling them to serve the church. And remember, we got all this stuff about this body here. Now let me go back over here to Romans 12:3. For I say through the grace given unto me, so he's speaking through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. Now, guys, we've talked about faith. You know, I try to bring this down without going through our six-month class on faith. Paul says, I live by the faith of the Son of God. You can ask people, what is faith? 99.99999% people don't know what faith is. Everybody's got a different. I believe faith is this. Well, I believe faith is we've got to have faith. By faith, they say they don't. I said, well, what is faith? Paul said that the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. Let me say it this way. The faith of the Son of God is Jesus Christ is the Son of God. It's His understanding of the Father. So I want to live out of His understanding, because you bring your understanding in and we got a mess. Because your understanding is different than my understanding, it's different than your understanding. It's different. And we got to bring all that to the cross, because only one understanding counts here, and that's the understanding of the Son of God. I want to live out of His understanding. I don't even have to understand His understanding. But I walk in the light as He is in the light, and He has made unto me wisdom. You see? This all comes into knowing of the Lord. And this is what we call what? Eternal life. This is what Paul is speaking out of. Now this may sound like a whole bunch of words, guys, but this is, Paul wouldn't even just say, I'm speaking. He says, I'm speaking out of this grace, out of this knowledge, out of this understanding. All Scripture is given by what? The inspiration of God. Paul said, I'm not just making this up. This isn't just a letter because I'm good with words. This is where this is coming from. Paul would say it this way in the Galatians. This is how I'm speaking to you. The life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. It's not I, but Christ liveth in me. That's what Paul is telling the Roman church right here. And you don't have to get caught up into these measures. God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. Don't get caught up in all these measurements here, because Christ is the endless measure. Look at verse 4. For as we have many members in one body, we were reading that in Corinthians, wasn't it? The eye and the ear and the smelling and the foot and the hand. For we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office. So we, being many, are one body in Christ, and every one members one of another. The function, listen to this, guys, this is all important. If you don't get anything from this today, get this right here. The function of grace in me is for you. Listen to what I'm telling you. The function of grace in you is for me. Do you understand that? The working of Christ in you is for me. The working of Christ in me is for you. So every time we fail to assemble ourselves together, every time we fail and don't bring in the, as we said, the fear of the Lord or the reverence of the body, what are we doing? We are hindering the body. Do you understand what I'm telling you here? In other words, and I know you guys get this, God has put grace in me. Maybe Jeff come here, and I'll just use Jeff as an example. So what is in me is for him. Okay? And he sent Clyde here today because whatever Clyde's got's for me. So if I don't show up, Jeff's... You see? So we minister. That's how he put the body together. He gives you one part that ministers to another. He gives you one part that ministers to another. So that the body would be one. We all needed each other. The hand can't say, well, you know what, guys? We're a hand ministry. Cut the hand off and see how good a ministry it is. I'm going to tell you what, guys. You can have a big, strapping, strong, 6'5", 295-pound linebacker with an ingrown toenail, and he ain't worth a hoot. Don't tell me the body don't fitly frame together and all points working. Right? One little thing in that body can shut the whole thing down. It's for the building up and the edifying. The function of grace is in that body, for the building up of that body, in the full recognition, in the full knowledge and acknowledgement of the mystery of God in Christ. Now listen to this. Verse 6. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given us. Remember, this is the same thing we read here in Corinthians, isn't it? Gifts differing according to the grace that is given us, whether prophecy, what that is, you know what prophecy is. That's, it's preaching, but what is prophecy? It's the testimony of Jesus Christ. That's what preaching is. It's the testimony of Jesus Christ. I'm not going to sit here and tell you how good a person you are. I start holding you up, and we all go to the house. Start holding me up, and we all go to the house. I'm going to get you to turn to see him. Let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith. What he's saying here is, let's do not reach beyond our comprehension of Christ. If you do, you find yourself in the flesh. You know, there's tails. You know what a tail is, you know. I use these things when people I know is talking outside of their bounds of the revelation of Jesus Christ. You start talking and then somebody throws this, well, I believe this. Right? That's kind of a telltale that you don't know what you're really talking about. And you have went so far with Christ, but that's as far as you went and your imagination has took over. There's no dividing line between real revelation and imagination. Your imagination has went, woo! We got a whole TV full. Religious channels of all kinds of imaginations and prophecies and all this kind of crazy weird stuff. Because they're speaking from the flesh because they've been outside of the bounds of Christ. Remember, this is a continue knowing him, walking in him, walking in the light as he is in the light, continuous revelation of him. But I know I've done it. We get a revelation of Jesus Christ and we run back and think we know it all. Hey, this is it. And what we've done is we've left him and then we've gotten in trouble. Then we get in trouble. And when I say according to the proportion of faith, according to the present acknowledgement of a revelation. I say present because the function of Christ in my soul is not to make a preacher out of me. Y'all understand that? It's not to make a preacher out of you. The function of grace, the function of Christ in you is to transform my soul and your soul into the image of Jesus Christ. the work of God in you and in me by grace is that he would have a son in the image of the firstborn, in the image of the only begotten, yes, individually and corporately. And it's out from that that we speak and that we minister. All of these are functions of grace and expressions of grace. That's why we should never, look what he says, think soberly, not to think more highly of himself. Because the first thing you will do when you get wrapped up in the flesh is somebody's going to be exalted. Even if it ain't you, it will be for your benefit because you will ride on Johnny's coattails to the top. Again, what have we done here? We have made a work, and we start looking at the outcome, having an invested interest. We just made an idol. The grace. But he says this right here, for I say through the grace, grace, that's the divine influence upon the heart and a reflection in the life. The spiritual condition of one governed. What are we talking about, spiritual condition of one governed? We're talking about the kingdom of heaven. We should let our function in Christ as his body be the power of divine grace. Not might, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. We say those things a whole lot, but do we really, you know? Now let me ask you a question. Do you know what the true power of divine grace is? I mean, this is our central text. Do you know what the true power of divine grace is? Now, we have been staying with this verse here for a long time. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. That is not the power of divine grace. That's a defining statement of grace. So, what is the defining power of, what is the power of grace? Here it is, guys. Galatians 2:20. Here's the power of grace. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Verse 21, I do not frustrate the grace of God. The power of grace is in my absence and his presence. What did he tell Paul? In your weakness, my strength is made perfect. That's what he's referred to back over here in Romans when he says the grace, according to the grace that is given to me. And my God, how has that been misunderstood and misrepresented and misused? And he brings that right here into the body, into the Corinthians. He brings that right, this narration, right into the body. The Corinthians were misusing it. There was many sick among them, weren't they? Many already dead. That's chapter 11. All you got to do is flip the page back and read chapter 11. These who were supposed to be in the Spirit. These that come behind and no spiritual gift. These who had grace had been given in full measure, yet in their church, they were dropping like flies. So Paul's got to come in. I mean, these guys had misused the reality of the communion. They had misused the reality of baptism. They had no knowledge of the resurrection. All these things right here in Corinthians. So how could we expect them to have the knowledge of the true function of Christ or the work of the Spirit or the expression of grace? He's not limiting the function of Christ in his body. He is bringing it from the realm of the flesh into the realm
into the reality of the Spirit, of the grace of God in Christ Jesus. Remember, Paul said this. I'll just give you this scripture. Paul said this in Romans 5:21, that as sin hath reigned unto death. In other words, sin was the ruler. Reign means in charge, right? Sin reigned unto death. Even so might grace reign or rule through righteousness, the spiritual condition of one governed by the power of divine grace. Just like a sin is reigned, now grace can reign. And how does grace reign? Through this power, through righteousness. But how Paul says, that I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. I'll bring this around. We'll close it out. We first encounter the grace of God at the cross. Type and shadow, Israel encountered the grace of God, at the door with the blood on, down there in Egypt. Now listen to this. Grace was not that God did something to Egypt on their behalf. You know what that did? All that did is make Pharaoh mad. I'm telling you, flies and frogs and darkness and hail and water turned to blood, all that did was tick Pharaoh off. They encountered grace at the door with the blood on it. When they came in, they entered in by the door. It was a blood-covered door. We then encounter that same grace first through our death with Christ. Then we encounter the same grace as the fullness of Christ working in us, the measure. And the wisdom and acknowledgement of faith which comes by grace is not I, but Christ liveth in me. Now, I'm going to give you these verses right here, this will be it. The express or function of grace is Christ working in the believer for what purpose? For the good of the whole. For the edifying, right? So here it is. This is the working of grace right here. Ephesians 4. And we'll start at verse 12. For the perfecting of the saints. For the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith. Guys, let me tell you something here. What if, we got a little baby right here, daddy's holding a little baby. What if we took Oakley's big toe, Oakley's the mature part of the body, he's the big toe, and we put that big toe on that body right back there? It's going to look pretty weird, isn't it? This whole body is going to grow up together. Right? If her arm starts to grow and the other arm's not, we're going to take the baby to the doctor because something's wrong. So this is never about you becoming all spiritual while everybody else is left behind. The more spiritual you become means you need to start ministering to others to the body, because we all grow together, and he says this body is going to become one. I don't care how spiritual you and holier than thou you think you are. I've got a whole body here, a whole bunch of members, and they're all one. So if you've got it going on, you need to start ministering to old Johnny sitting beside him, because that's why you got it going on. I give it to you because old Johnny's short over here. Okay? You need to get a hold of that. Till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God. What are we coming to? That I know a bunch and I know all this? Till we come to the knowledge of the Son of God. What did we say that was? To the faith. To his understanding. Unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. What we're talking about here, until that child becomes full grown. Full grown. Why? Here it is, verse 14. That we henceforth be no more. What does henceforth mean? From now on. That we henceforth be no more children. Children. Because what is a child? He's tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lay in wait to deceive. A child doesn't know. A child can be deceived. Right? But when you become mature and somebody tries to deceive you, you're aware of the scam. And you say, not so, because I used to get tossed to and fro. Every time somebody said something, I was bouncing here, I was bouncing there. And every time the wind blew, I was believing this and believing this. I was caught in every circumstance. And I was, my life was up. You know, you hear people say, boy, I'm having a good day. And then all of a sudden, I'm having a bad day. That's a child. That's a child's day. I used to always think when I get on the school bus in seventh grade and I'm hearing some girl is all smiling in the morning because she's going to see her boyfriend, but then that afternoon she got her head up against the window and she's listening to Duran Duran, you know, some crazy song, and they're about to cry over there because old Johnny broke up with her. You see, up and down, up and down, up and down. That's a child's life. Well, says the mature ones aren't that way. Circumstances don't bother. But speaking the truth, how? In love. Let me tell you what the love of God is. The love of God is Jesus Christ. I asked people, they said, well, love means to do good and to be good and to love everybody. And I'm thinking, so you don't have a clue what the love of God is. The love of God is Jesus Christ. Speaking the truth in Christ. I could say it that way. That we may grow up unto Him in all Christ. From whom the whole body fitly joined together, compacted, by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh the increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. My God, do you... Do you understand what I just told you right here, guys? I'm telling you, and this goes for the body of Christ everywhere. Everybody in the body of Christ needs everybody else in the body of Christ. You have been compacted, every joint supplying what the other joint needs. Do you understand that? So guys, I'm telling you, I hope this will take root in you and you, that you begin to understand how vitally important each and every one in here is. Whether you're standing up here, whether you're playing keyboards, whether you're playing guitars or singing or just coming in, nobody is above everybody. Every joint in this room is supplying every other joint. We need each other, and if one is missing, the body suffers. Now think about that. They're not going to miss me today. Come on, guys. It'd be like just cutting your finger off. Just cutting your finger off, or just cut your foot off, or just, you know, take your liver out. The body needs everybody. Why? To edify itself, speaking the truth in love, that we might grow up into Him, into all things, in the fullness of all things. In love. Do you understand that? And it's vitally important. I know this message may not be exciting, but to me it just kind of sets right down home. And I think, I didn't understand how important this really was. I just really didn't understand. I hadn't even began at wisdom yet. Wisdom hadn't even began with me because I didn't understand the reverence. You know, this ain't about me preaching, or this is irrelevant, guys. This is irrelevant. This is so that we would grow up. I mean, just, you know, when I always sometimes think of these things in natural terms. But I'll just say this, and I'll give this back over to Jeff and Patty. And think about your own kids. Just think about your own kids a minute. I hope this will hit home with you. And you being a parent, you have what they need. Okay? You have what they need. How would it be if you didn't supply them what they needed? Now just think, I mean, we take kids away from parents today for that very thing, and the natural don't. They don't feed them. They don't wash them. They don't clothe them. They don't provide for them. You know, the scripture says the children don't lay up for the parents. The parents lay up for the children. How would it be? So here it is in the body of Christ, the real reality. Remember, this is the real reality. One body, many members. And what if you don't supply the other members of that body? You hold back for whatever reason. Now, sometimes we're just ignorant of it. Now, I'm not talking, guys, I'm not talking nothing natural here. I'm not talking money. I'm not talking clothes and houses and all that. I'm talking spiritual, edifying one another. And so we're all ministers here to minister to one another. And guys, even though you may not minister to anybody in this room, you're going to encounter the body of Christ when you leave here. Out there in Walmarts and over in Food City and in Baptist Valley. So what are you going to do? Because guys, we're going to grow together. We're going to grow together. The body is going to grow up together. This ain't going to be all you, Mr. Spiritual, and you're flying away. This body is going to grow up together. So whatever you've got, guys, it's for somebody else. Remember that. Whatever you have is for somebody else.